Welcome back. In the last video, I have discussed about SCTP. What is SCTP? Packet, packet format, etc. So now I am going to discuss about SCTP association and TCP-SCTP comparison. SCTP association. Just like TCP, SCTP also is a connection-oriented protocol. A connection in SCTP is known as an association, whereas in TCP we will simply say as a connection, here it is association. It emphasizes a multi-homing. We have already discussed about multi-homing. Now, for a communication to take place, there are three phases: association establishment, that means connection establishment, data transfer, and association termination. The association establishment is done by using four-way handshaking. In TCP, we have learned the connection establishment by means of three-way handshaking. Here it is four-way handshaking. So, first point is association establishment. The idea is similar to that in TCP. The difference is there it is three-way handshaking and here it is four-way handshaking. The side which initiates the communication is, or they initiate the connection association, is said to be in active open stage, and the other side is said to be in passive open stage. And in the example for TCP, we were considering it as client and server. Here also we are using the same idea. So this figure explains how a connection is established or an association is established in SCTP by means of four-way handshaking. Here this is a client side. Client will be in active open state, and this is a server side which will be in passive open state. So the here client initiates the connection, means it sends the first packet, which is termed as init, and this is received by the server process, which then sends back init ACK and along with cookie. And this, about this cookie, I will discuss this in detail later. So this init ACK plus cookie reaches the client. Now the client now sends the third packet, that is cookie echo. It echoes the cookie sent by the server, and also the cookie, it reaches the server side. Now the server sends the cookie acknowledgement to acknowledge the cookie, and this fourth packet reaches the client. Thus we have four packets from the client side to server: first packet, second packet from the server side to the client, third packet sent by the client to the server, and fourth packet from the server to the client. That is four-way handshaking. Now the connection or the association is established. So this is explained here. The client sends the first packet, which contains the init chunk. I have already told you that in SCTP context, the data is termed as, the unit of data is termed as chunk. So here the first packet contains init chunk, The server sends the second packet, which contains the init ACK chunk containing cookie. The client sends third packet, which includes cookie echo chunk. Actually, echo means whatever is received will be sent back. Here also, cookie echo chunk is a simple chunk that echoes without just any change the cookie sent by the server. One more important thing to remember is that HTTP allows inclusion of data chunks in this packet, that is in the cookie echo chunk as well as in the next packet, that is cookie ACK chunk. In both these, HTTP allows inclusion of data chunks. So fourth packet is sent by the server, which includes cookie acknowledgement chunk, which actually acknowledges the receipt of cookie echo chunk. Now some important facts related to this is SYN flooding attack is solved by cookie. The problem of SYN flooding attack has been discussed in TCP. This means a malicious attacker sends number of connection requests and the server will accept this request and will allocate resources, and finally the server will get crashed. This is the problem of SYN flooding attack. Actually, this problem is solved in HTTP. So here in HTTP, the resource allocation is postponed until the third packet arrives. Whereas in TCP, resource allocation is done earlier, and only because of that, the server becomes congested or the server collapses. So here the resource allocation is postponed until the third packet arrives. So for this purpose, the information received in the first packet is to be saved until the third packet arrives. That is, the first packet is sent from the client to the server, and third packet also comes from the client to the server. So this third, the information received in the first packet is to be saved. However, this requires memory. So this is solved, this need of extra memory is solved by packing the information back to the client, that is cookie, packing the information back to the client. There are two potential situations in this context. First one, if the sender of the first packet is an attacker, server never receives the third packet, means cookie is lost and hence no resource allocation takes place. As the resource allocation is not done, there is no problem of crashing of the server. B, if the sender is genuine. If it is so, the sender receives the second packet with cookie. Once this is received, the sender, that is the client, will send the third packet and the server sends the fourth packet, and hence association is established. This strategy works if no entity can eat a cookie baked by the server. This is a quote from a textbook which is very much suited for this situation. So actually cookie is created by the server. So this can be, to guarantee this, the server creates, to guarantee the solution to SYN flooding attack, the server creates a digest, what is known as digest, from the information received using its own secret key. This fact you can compare with cryptography, that is, for the purpose of security, there's plain text, that is actual text, is transformed to a cipher text format by using keys. Same idea is used here. Here the server creates something known as a digest from the information received from the client, from the information received from the client as the first packet, that is in the init packet. And this, for this purpose, the server is using a secret key. And now what the server does is, it will pack the information received and this digest means digest is created by the server using the secret key, and the information is received received from the client as the first packet. So this information and digest is packed together, and which is known as a cookie. And this cookie is sent to the client. And once this second packet reaches the client will naturally will send the third packet. And when this third packet comes back, server calculates the digest again. This cryptography concept itself. If it matches with the already sent cookie, it's fine, okay, everything is fine. Means it is a genuine user. Now comes the second point, data transfer. Once the association is established, bidirectional data transfer takes place. Means both directions data is transferred. Like TCP, HTTP also supports piggybacking. And one more important thing is that HTTP recognizes and maintains frame boundaries. Each message from a process, see, I'm telling you, each message from a process is treated as a single unit and is inserted into the data chunk, provided it is not fragmented. So from this it is clear that sometimes it needs fragmentation. The question comes, if the size of the message is more than the maximum transfer unit MTU size, then it is to be fragmented. Otherwise, it is treated as a single unit. In the case of TCP, there is no such boundary, only stream concept is taken. And while transferring data, in the previous video, I have discussed about the numbering system, that is TSN, SI, SSN, etc. In connection with numbering of the data chunks. So actually only data chunks are having TSNs, transmission sequence number, and also only data chunks are acknowledged, and the acknowledgement chunks are known as SACK, SACK, SACK chunks. And as HTTP supports multi-homing, so data transfer is multi-homing data transfer. Also, we have already discussed that HTTP is having multiple streams are there between same processes. For a single process to process delivery, multiple streams are there. So this data transfer is taking place as multi-stream delivery. So this figure shows the data transfer. Here The transmission sequence number is 7105. It's a data chunk. Only data chunk is having that number. And next number is 7106. This packet is sent to the server. Even without waiting for the acknowledgement, next packet is also sent. It also contains two data chunks with TSN 7107 and 7108. And now the server sends the acknowledgement as well as the data chunk from the server to the client. So here the TSN, cumulative TSN of the SAC chunk, this is not the data chunk, this pink colored portion represents the SAC chunk, that is acknowledgement of the last received data chunk. Here the last received data chunk is 7108, so TSN, the cumulative TSN is 7108. This means it has received all the packet up to 7108. Also, this is the data chunk and the TSN number is 121, that is this is from server to client side. It also sends two data chunks, the TSN 122. Here you can see that there is no SAC because already the SAC is sent, 7108 is sent. Now after that no data chunk has arrived from the client to the server. So simply the server sends its data chunk to the client. So and the next packet you can see it is having a cumulative TSN 122 and this is an acknowledgement chunk, that is acknowledgement for the data chunk 122. And like this the data transmission continues. And in the previous video I have discussed about the concept of TSN, SI and SSNs as far as a packet is considered. So before trying to learn this, you must have a look at that figure also. Next comes association termination. Here either end may terminate, that is a client may want to terminate or a client may initiate termination of association, or even the server may initiate the association termination. While comparing with TCP, the difference here is that in TCP there is a, it allows a situation known as half close, that is one end wants to stop or wants to terminate the connection as it is not having any data to send, whereas the other end is still having data to send. So this is half close. But in the case of SCTP, it does not allow half close. That means if one end closes, the other end must also close. Or in other words, no new data can be sent. And there is a possibility that there are leftover packets in the queue. That is when one end requests for close, then in the queue of the other end, it's a possibility of packets remaining. So they are sent and then only it is closed. And in the case of association termination, SCTP is using three-way handshaking, as in the case of connection establishment of TCP. This is explained in this figure. Here actually in the figure active close is shown in the case of client, means in this example client is initiating close, and whereas at this situation server is in passive close, means server is also ready to close, there is no problem regarding this. So in order to close or in order to terminate, The client sends a chunk known as shutdown. And with the cumulative TSN is also shown here. This cumulative TSN is the acknowledgement number of the last received packet from the server. As this shutdown chunk, this packet reaches the server, the server sends the shutdown ACK. Only acknowledgement is sent and it reaches the client side. And now the client sends the third packet, that is shutdown complete, and it reaches the server side. Now connection is terminated. So these chunks, that is init ACK, echo, cookie echo, then shutdown ACK, shutdown complete, all these are actually known as control chunks. As we have discussed earlier, in the case of SCTP, we have both data chunks and control chunks. So these are examples of control chunks. Comparison between a TCP segment and an SCTP packet. From the figure itself, we can understand the differences between the two. And this is a TCP segment and this is an SCTP packet. Here actually we are considering this segment as having two parts, one data part and other is header part. And in the case of SCTP packet, it is shown as a data part, a control part and a header part. That means in the case of TCP, the control part, that is control flags, are a part of the header itself, whereas in the case of SCTP, they are not a part of the header. On the other hand, it constitutes a different area. And here we have data chunk in the place of data bytes. There is no options field in SCTP. Now coming to the first two fields. Here it is a source port address, destination port address for TCP segment. In the same way, packet of SCTP is having source port address and destination port address. As you know, in transport layer, we are using process to process delivery. Both TCP and SCTP are process to process. Both of these provides process to process communication. So naturally they need port address. That's why here source port address and destination port address. And about as a general view, you can say sequence number, that is segment sequence number is there. Here we have already discussed that we have TSN, SSN and SA, etc. And this is about checksum. Here in a TCP also there is checksum, but TCP it is 16 bit and SCTP it is 32 bit, and like that. We can check these fields one by one in detail. So the control information in TCP, that means six flags are there for control. They are a part of header. In SCTP, it is actually included in the control chunk. And in the case of control chunks, there are different types of control chunks and they are used for different purposes. For example, I have already discussed about init ACK, cookie echo. These control chunks are related to association establishment, whereas shutdown, acknowledgement, etc. are associated with association termination. This I will discuss later. And in TCP, the segment is treated as a single entity. SCTP packets can carry several data chunks and each can belong to different stream. As there are multiple streams from one process to another process, this multi-streaming facility is available in SCTP. And about the optional part, there is no options part in SCTP. And about the size of the header, in the case of TCP, the minimum size of header is 20 bytes and maximum is 60. And when it becomes 60, when we are using the options part. But in the case of SCTP, the header is only 12 bytes. And there is no options part. I told you already that checksum is 32 bit and in TCP it is 16 bit. And now about the verification tag, this field is discussed in detail in the packet format of SCTP earlier. So verification tag in SCTP is actually an association identifier. So that means connection identifier. And SCTP uses multi-homing using different IP addresses, that is also already discussed, whereas this facility is not there in TCP. Actually, TCP uses a combination of IP address and port address to define a connection. Now about the sequence number, TCP includes sequence number in the header, which is actually the number of the first byte in the segment. That is byte numbering concept you have discussed in the TCP section. And in SCTP, packet can include many different data chunks. And these data chunks are identified using TSNs, SIs and SSNs. So in the place of sequence number, here we are using a combination of all these. And in the case of TCP, the control information, 6 flags are there, SYN, FIN, SYN for connection establishment, FIN for connection termination, etc. And this consumes one sequence number. Whereas, the control chunks in SCTP never use TSN, SI or SSN. These three numbering system belongs to only data chunks, not to the whole packet. So that's all about TCP and SCTP. Thank you.